And point number four, Catholicity takes into account the multifaceted, multidimensional character of human development. Reductionism is the opposite of Catholicism. To be reductionist is, you know, to have a very limited thinking. Makitid ang utak, hanggang dun lang. Ang Katoliko, malawak ang pag-isip. There are many aspects, different facets to human nature. And we haven't discovered enough, so we're still open to possibilities. That's why even our doctrines evolve. In spite of the tendency on the part of some doctrinaires to say, it was always like this, it will always be like this, forever and ever. And it's easy on the part of people who are familiar with the history of the Christian faith. Easy to establish that even our faith evolved. We did not believe that slavery was immoral before, did we? We did not believe before that forcing people into marriage out of pre-arranged marriage was immoral. Did we? Kahit na mga ninuno natin, ang lola ko nga eh. Minsan, nagbigay ako ng recollection and I was talking about, you know, invalid marriages. Nung malaman niya, nakapagpilit lang pala, napilit lang yung kinakasal, hindi pala valid yung marriage. Lumapit siya sa akin, naka-crisis siya. Nasabi niya, ibig mo sabihin, hindi valid ang kasal ko. Sabi ko, lola, bakit? Eh, pinagkasundo lang kami ng lolo mo. Ganun mo lang talaga naman, sabi niya. Talaga? So, hindi valid ang kasal ko, sabi niya. Sandali lang, lola, sabi ko, ilan ang anak niyo ni Lolo? Siya, sabi niya. Ibig mo sabihin, Lola, sa loob ng isinilang ng siyam na anak, hindi mo natutunang mahalin ng Lolo ko. Ikaw naman, siyempre. Pero mo muna, hindi mo kilala yan, sabi niya. Ngayon, Lola, nung tubuan ka na ng pag-ibig sa Lolo ko, yung invalid mo kasal, na-validate mo. Pero come to think of it, oo nga, no. It was really valid. Eh kung hindi tinubuan ng pag-ibig ang lola, eh kung up to the last moment of her life, medyan hindi ko binahal yung tao niya. She has a basis for an amen, di ba? Invalid yung kasal. They were forced into it by their parents. Mga bagay na yan, hindi kinu-question mo. Kaya paano tayo naniniwan, it has always been like this, it will always be like this. Kapag sinara mo na ang sarili mo at ang utak mo sa mga bagong karanasan, hindi ka na Katoliko. And I think this Pope is being consistent with Catholic. Because he cannot afford to be reductionist in support. Just three preliminaries established. Number one, Catholicity is not limited to religious affiliation. Even if we claim to be Catholic, Catholicity is not limited to Roman Catholics. Number two, we have no monopoly on Catholicity. Then number three, Catholicity is sometimes forfeited by some Catholics. That there are people who call themselves Catholics who behave in a very un-Catholic way. Ito yung gusto kong i-establish muna as preliminaries. Kasi pag sinabing Katoliko, immediately, Roman Catholic. But what is Catholicity about? Catholicity is a form of spirituality. It's a whole way of life. It's a way of looking at the world and at reality as such. It's a whole orientation about God that in turn informs one's understanding about self, about humankind, and about the world. Ano ang tingin mo sa Diyos? Natural, kung ang tingin mo sa Diyos ay sa'yo lang siya. And there was a time when Israel thought God was God only of Israel. Ibig sasabihin mo, ang Diyos ko, iba sa Diyos mo. Ang Diyos ko, iba sa Diyos mo. So, kami lang ang nililigtas ng Diyos na ito. Your orientation about God informs your understanding of yourself, of humankind, and of the world. The spirituality of Catholicity goes with a whole set of values and principles, as well as norms of thinking, speech, and behavior that one might not even be fully conscious of. A set of values and principles. Minsan, hindi man tayo conscious that they are at work in us. Let's take a look, for example, at what we call the Bible, collection of writings. Between 39 to 53 books are regarded as canonical, meaning recognized as inspired literature by Jews of various traditions. Yung difference ng Biblia natin sa Biblia ng Protestante has nothing to do with Protestants and Catholics. Namana lang natin yan. It had to do already with the difference between diaspora Jews and homeland Jews. Meron silang kanina yung set of collections of scriptures, what we call the canon. And Christians too differ in their canons for the Old Testament. You know, Oriental Christians have between 50 to 53 books in the Old Testament. The Roman Catholics would have 46 books. The Protestants would have 39 books in the Old Testament. Nagbabago-bago, depending on what they believe to be inspired literature. But if there is one thing very obvious about Israel, about the Israelite faith, is that it began as a religion of the disenfranchised. A faith that attracted those that shared in the common experience of marginality. Ito yung isang bagay na akala natin theory ng liberation theologians. No, no, it's in the scriptures. This is not about liberation theology. It's the biblical input. Israel believed in a God who was on the side of the disenfranchised. Kaya, the people who shared in this common faith shared also in the common experience of marginality, of being mga latak ng lipunan. The basic creed of Israel is a narrative about a people's liberation from slavery in Egypt by their God, Yahweh. Yun ang kanilang basic narrative. We were, you know, slaves in Egypt and the Lord liberated us. Yahweh liberated us. My father was a wandering Aramean. Few in number, they came down to Egypt and became prosperous. They multiplied until they became slaves. And they cried to God, and God heard their cry of affliction. So their narratives of freedom and covenant relationship with a God who was on the side of the slaves attracted other landless tribes to affiliate with them and to identify with their aspirations for freedom and nationhood. Kaya hindi naman talaga homogeneous, ethnically speaking, ang Israel. Yung common belief natin ay yung Israel, this is an ethnic identity that has to do with the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. That's according to the narrative. But the sociological reality was something else. This people was a conglomeration of different tribal groups that shared only in one common denominator. They shared in the faith in a God who is on the side of the disenfranchised, the God on the side of the slaves. Kaya ibang klaseng religion ang Yahweh religion. Most other religions are religions of the ruling class. Most other religions are religions of the kings and the queens, of the monarchic families. No, Israel is a religion of the underprivileged, of the religion of the disenfranchised, of the slaves. That's a basic input in the Israelite faith. And many other people were attracted. Other people who shared in the same experience. Most of them, landless tribes, nomads. Ito yung mga tao nung in the ancient world, these were the people who didn't have their own cities. They were just, you know, like the Bedouins, like the nomads, gypsies. They go where the grass is green. And then the people who live in the cities feel very insecure about their presence. Itatabi yan. From a small tribe of Hebrew nomads, Israel grew into a confederation of tribes that would be forced by circumstances to go beyond their own cultures and cultic traditions in favor of a shared Yahwistic faith. Have you ever encountered that book, The Tribes of Yahweh, Norman Gottwald? This has become a very common theory about the origin of Israel. Because hindi talaga totoong they were a cohesive, homogeneous ethnic tribe belonging to the same family. That has been debunked already. No, these people, they actually represented different tribes and even different cultic traditions. May kanya-kanya silang Diyos-Diyosan. And most of their gods were called Elohim. And Elohim is plural for El. Kaya may kanya-kanya silang El. Depending on where they are, they were in worship. Kaya El or Al, Allah, is the same. Allah, El, basically means their God, their deity. Some of them worship a God called El Shaddai. And that El Shaddai is the God of a mountain, associated with a particular mountain. Their mighty God, the strong God. Some worship God in a place called Bethel and call him El Bethel. Some would worship this God in Beersheba and call him El Beersheba. May kanya-kanyang El sila. Meron sila kanya-kanyang little shrines where they put up, you know, where they worship their own deities, local tribal deities. So, paano nagkaisa itong mga tao? When they call it confederation, a tribal confederacy. Because they shared only one common denominator, yung being marginalized. So, they became very insecure and hapless vis-a-vis the world empires. And they found themselves clinging to each other, and somehow the most important element that brought them together was the common faith. Kaya yung Ten Commandments, parang constitution yan. Gusto niyo magkaisa tayo, magkasundo muna tayo. Wala tayong ibang sasambahin kundi si Yahweh. Magkasundo tayo. We will not take the name of our God in vain. Magkasundo tayo that we will keep holy a Sabbath day, that we will honor our parents, that we will not kill, that we will not steal. The basic tenets that they agreed upon. And so the earliest form of union was a tribal confederacy, apparently. Now the seeds of Catholicity are to be found already in the primitive stages of the faith of Israel. The seed of Catholicity is that which will open up a faith group to outsiders and recognize the inclusive nature of its own faith experience. Dati-dati, they worship their own Diyos-Diyosan, their own gods. And then, they got to know each other. Pare-pareho ko lang experience nila. Their common experience was, well, they were oppressed. They were taken in as slaves. They were vulnerable. Their children, their women, were taken in. Sometimes they would just be attacked. These very powerful cities, you know, armies. And so they banded together. The fact that they could open themselves to other faith groups because of a common experience would allow their faith to evolve. In short, that the faith of one tribe can be shared by the other tribes. And integration can be made possible by a process of mutual accommodation. They learn to accommodate each other. And that process of mutual accommodation eventually gave birth to a new faith. Meron akong favorite biblical scholar na German, pangalan Martin Dorf. And this guy is one of the first to propose what he calls the major themes of the Pentateuch as coming from different tribal traditions. Different tribal traditions. Which eventually coalesced into the epic story of Israel. Nagkaroon ng interaction ng different tribal traditions. Iba-iba yung narratives nila. Some of them have narratives that evolved around the deity making promises to their ancestors. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph. Still others clung to a basic narrative about liberation from slavery in Egypt. And there were those desert dwellers who had beautiful narratives about a God who accompanied them in their journey of survival in the desert. And there were mountain dwellers also, whose narrative revolves around a god of the mountain, Mount Sinai. And of course, the common narrative of the quest for a fertile land, promised land. And Martin Mill says, you juggle together these things and then you have the basic narrative of the temperature. And you think it's a coherent story? It's not. It's not really a very coherent story. It's pieced together, stitched together from many various traditions. I call this a Catholic process. This coming together of tribal narratives into an epic story of Israel made way for the emergence of Israel from a tribe to a nation. Israel started as just a nomadic tribe. Sino ba sila when they entered the Promised Land? What right did they have to occupy Canaan? It even sounds very unjust what they did. They're outsiders. They came from Egypt, according to the story. They wandered through the desert until they reached Canaan. And when they reached Canaan, there was an established community there. And they attacked that community. Remember the fall of Jericho, the walls of Jericho tumbling down, all of that. That's the narrative. And it's been very difficult for some biblical scholars to establish the factuality of the idea of occupation. And more, they're observing that there was no occupation that took place. It's like they really settled peacefully and coexisted with the other tribes and influenced the direction of the Canaanite society to such an extent that they were able to unite this society into a larger Israel. And so from a tribal religion, the Israelite faith would become a national religion. Dati-dati, si Yahweh ay Diyos lang ng isang tribo. Nung nagkaisa sila, si Yahweh naging Diyos ng isang bayan. Nagkasundo sila. Siguro sabi nila, okay ha, mula ngayon, yung El Shaddai mo na lang, Yahweh din yan ha. Yung El Be'er Sheba mo, El Shalom mo, El Olam mo, lahat yan, Yahweh. It's the same God. Your God, my God. And if we're worshiping the same God, we follow the same rules. We don't kill, we don't steal, we don't commit adultery, etc. Are we agreed? Yes, we're agreed. Okay. They're able to establish a nation. They call that the process of Catholicity. What makes it possible? The opening of minds. The opening of minds that these other tribes are not bad people. They're also fellow sufferers. We can interact with them. We can even share faith with them. You know, it's even as a sociological thing, it's a very fascinating to analyze, to reflect on the emergence of what we call an Israelite faith, a united Israelite faith. Kaya tinatawag natin 12 tribes na parang lahat yan ay anak. Anak ni Jacob, you know? It's so hard to defend ethnically. There's such a varied people brought together by circumstances. Now, there are two parallel but distinct expressions of Judaism. At some point, they split pa yung Judaism into homeland Judaism and diaspora Judaism because of circumstances. They were a united kingdom only for several centuries. Later on, they were divided. And then they were conquered by the Syrians, and then by the Babylonians, and then they were exiled, and then they got scattered. Some of them returned, and so there are the homeland Jews who are returnees. They resettled in the homeland. But the majority of them, they became migrants. They remained abroad. You know, tayo mga Pinoy, mas madali natin maintindihan ang istorya ng Israel kasi parang ganun din ang istorya natin. Dalawang klase ng Pinoy, homeland Pinoys and diaspora Pinoy. We can relate with the biblical data. And the diaspora Jews were based in major civilized cities outside Palestine. They tended to integrate with the societies in the civilized cities outside Palestine. The homeland Jews were based in Palestine. First spoke only Hebrew, eventually they spoke only Aramaic. And at some point, they found it very difficult to communicate with each other. There are many diaspora Jews. Imagine a Jew born in Rome, a Jew born in Spain, a Jew born in Alexandria, a Jew born in Nineveh, but coming to Jerusalem on pilgrimage during Passover. They're speaking different languages. Kaya maintindihan mo yung Pentecost. Pare-pareho sila ng pananampalataya, pero iba-iba ng kultura ang binagulan. Kasi nagkalat na sila sa buong daigdig. Judaism became particularly attractive to the Gentiles. And so when the Jews got exiled in foreign lands, they built up synagogues. Ang mga sinagoga, parang mga kapilya natin. The only difference is they're not temples. They did not rebuild the temple. And they did not build temples abroad. There was an effort to build one temple in Leontopolis in Egypt. But, you know, that was the only unique case and it didn't last very long. Kasi ang difference ng temple, temple is a place where they offered sacrifices. And temples were run by the priestly class. Synagogues are not run by priests. Synagogues are run by lay people who are called rabbi. And what brings people together in the synagogue is no longer sacrifice, but the word of God. That is why they collected their writings. And Judaism became so attractive to the Gentiles because they were the only religion with a book, with a moral code, with beautiful narratives, stories. Kaya noong ang mga Hudyo ay nagtayo ng mga sinagoga in Rome, in Greece, in Babylon, in Egypt. Whenever they congregated, they attracted Gentiles also. Then those Gentiles would participate. They wanted to know about the stories. Kaya naging two layers ang mga synagogues. Kaya nagkaroon sila ng courtyard of the Gentiles. The inner circle, the inner square, is for Jews only. The women are sort of secluded, as in Islam, no? Women and children, special chambers, sumisilip-silip. But the Gentiles were allowed. They created a special courtyard of the Gentiles. Kaya nung nagwala si Jesus sa temple, and he said, "Stop making my Father's house into a marketplace. My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations, but you have made it a den of thieves." A house of prayer for all the nations. He's referring to the courtyard of the Gentiles that had been transformed by the Sadducees, the priestly class, into a place for buying and selling. And yet that space was supposed to be open to the Gentiles. So, Judaism, especially the synagogue community, became two-layered. The mainstream, the inner circle, would be the mainstream community, meaning the circumcised Jews. And the outer layer would be Gentiles. They are called proselytes, meaning Gentiles who are attracted to the scriptures, attracted to Judaism. But they could not be integrated into the community because they're not circumcised. They do not observe Sabbath. They eat pork. They do not observe the food regulations. Kaya may dalawang klaseng attendees in the synagogues. The inner circle of Jews and the outer circle of Gentile proselytes. Sometimes they're called Gentile converts to Judaism. They are converts in the sense that they're already attracted to Judaism, but they're never assimilated into Judaism. Minsan, ang tagal na nila nag-a-attend ng synagogue worship, but they're never integrated. Why? Because they're not with the chosen people. So at some point, naging restrictive na sila. So, you know, the biblical stories and the moral code provide us interesting topics for homilies by the rabbis during the synagogue services. Ito yung pinagbulan ng ating homiletic tradition. We picked it up from the rabbinic tradition. The whole tradition is very Jewish. Exile was no longer seen as a punishment for the sins of Israel. And you read that in Isaiah chapter 49. Noong una, ang paniwala nila, they were exiled because they were sinners. And God allowed them to be dispersed throughout the world. But now when you read Isaiah 49, you have a prophet who is proposing a different perspective for the exile. For him, the exile was a fulfillment of Yahweh's plan of making Israel a light to the Gentiles so that his salvation may reach the ends of the earth. Di ba sinasabi natin yan sa Simeon's Canticle? A light to reveal you to the Gentiles and the glory of his people Israel. That is being picked up from the Old Testament. The Israelite faith was taking on a new and higher form of Catholicity here. No longer a national, but a universal form of monotheism. Dati-rati, ang Diyos ng Israel ay Diyos ng isang tribo. When they became a nation, ang Diyos ng Israel ay Diyos ng buong bayan Israel. And now that they are dispersed all over the world, they begin to believe that Yahweh, their God, is not just God of Israel, but God of the whole world. And this is the beginning of what we call universal monotheism. Hindi na siya tribal monotheism, hindi na siya national monotheism, but universal monotheism. And they begin to say, there is only one God. It's not true that there are other gods. There's only one God. So Yahweh is no longer just God of Israel, as against the gods of the other nations and kingdoms. He is God of all nations. He is God of the whole world. But you know, this does not just happen through imposition of one God to the others. The process involves a very gradual form of integration. The idea of an Israel with a universal mission is what I would call Jewish Catholicism. Kaya napansin nyo, pag binasa nyo yung narratives about Abraham, about Isaac, and Jacob, you hear about the patriarchs having a universal mission. For example, in Genesis chapter 12, when Abraham is called, sabi ni Yahweh kay Abraham, I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. But by you, all the nations on the earth will bless themselves. So God is blessing Israel so that Israel could become a source of blessing for the whole world. That is a new development. The idea of a God who wants to save the whole world, not just Israel. Bago ito, sa kamalayan ng Israel mismo. They didn't think like this before. And of all things, this is happening already after the exile. And it is going to be projected back in their literature. Kaya medyo may complexity ngayon yung exegesis of the Old Testament. Because you're reading Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but you're not necessarily reading the time of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You're reading a putting together of a literature that reflects a much later period with a mentality that is more post-exilic than anything. So Christianity, as it were, became the alternative Judaism of the disenfranchised Jews. Okay, let me explain this. The beginnings of Christianity were really about a sectarian movement within Judaism. I think you'd agree with that. that the Jesus movement started as a sect within Judaism, a sectarian movement within Judaism. And Jesus himself limited his ministry within Israel, within Judah and Galilee, the Holy Land. We do not hear of Jesus going out to Rome, to Greece. No, he didn't travel very far. The only Gentiles he met were within that territory, within the Decapolis. Ngayon, at the beginning of the Christian faith, the early Christians were very exclusive. And they were headed by the apostles. Eh, mayroong isang tao na hindi naman apostol at hindi naman isa sa 12, ay biglang pumasok-pasok sa eksena. His name was Saul. He used to persecute the church. This became a big source of conflict for early Christianity. Anong karapatan ng tao ito na makialam sa atin, eh, he used to persecute the church. But he claimed to have met the risen Lord. But from a persecutor, he became a propagator of the Christian faith. And so, people started referring to him as an apostle. In principle, that's an anomaly. Why would he be an apostle? He wasn't even one of the 12. So this is the beginning of a new development in early Christianity. And this guy, who calls himself an apostle to the Gentiles, will not limit the proclamation of the gospel to Jewish converts. Noong una, ang mga unang yumakap sa pananampalatayang Kristiyano, yung mga Hudyo, exclusively Jewish. And they all intended to make Christianity exclusive to Jewish converts. Until Paul came into the scene. And he brought the Christian faith, the gospel, to the synagogues outside the Holy Land. Nung una, pumunta siya sa mga sinagoga, and he would direct the gospel mainly to the Jews in the synagogues. Eh, ayaw siya pakinggan ang mga Jews in the synagogue. He turned to the Gentile converts outside. Remember, I was telling you, 2 layers na yung umaattend ng synagogue service. Yung inner layer of a small company of mainstream Jews, and the outer layer, which is majority, who are Gentile proselytes or converts to Judaism, but not integrated into Judaism. And so, ang ginawa ni Paul, dahil ayaw siyang tanggapin ng mainstream Jews, he went out to the outer layer and proclaimed Jesus to them. And they were quicker and faster in embracing Jesus at the Messiah. Yun ang sinasabi ng Acts 14:27, that the door of faith had been opened to the Gentiles. Na dati-rate, ang pananampalatayang Kristiyano was exclusive to Jewish converts. And somehow, the early Jesus also said that he came only for the lost sheep of the house of Israel, but only of Israel. Sino ang lost sheep? Tax collectors, prostitutes, sinners. Tax collectors who are Jewish, prostitutes who are Jewish, sinners who are Jewish, but still within the Israelite community. He's not talking about Gentiles, really. Kaya, when Paul welcomed Gentiles into the community, that was shocking for the Jerusalem leaders. Nagkaroon tuloy ng rift between Jerusalem and Antioch, because Paul was based in Antioch and he was working with the company of Barnabas. And in the meantime, the 12, Peter and James, they were all in the Holy Land, in Jerusalem. He questioned si Paul about what he was doing. Binalita sa mga apostol sa Jerusalem that he was baptizing uncircumcised members, that he was eating and drinking, you know, with Gentiles, meaning unclean food. What is unclean food? For example, pork, meaning he was eating pork. And he wasn't observing Sabbath day anymore. He was welcoming people who did not observe Sabbath day. For the Jerusalem community, this was unorthodox. For the Jerusalem community, Paul was a heretic at this time. What he was doing was wrong, unacceptable, not in keeping with dogma, not in keeping with their morals, not in keeping with their orthodoxy. And these are already members of the inner circle of Jesus. Nagkaroon ng intense conflict which had to be resolved by the first council. And I would call that a really Catholic council, the Council of Jerusalem. How did it happen that they opened their minds? It's the working of the Holy Spirit. Paul was able to persuade them that the conversion of the Gentiles was the work of the same Spirit. And this is Catholicity at work. And so Christianity became the alternative Judaism of the disenfranchised Jews. Early Christian assemblies became alternative synagogues, because later on they were expelled from the synagogue. And so they started congregating. After all, synagogue means to assemble. A synagogue. Synagogue in Greek would mean to congregate around, you know, the Torah. And since they couldn't go to the synagogues anymore because they had been expelled, they formed their own assemblies at home. These became alternative synagogues. And baptism became an alternative circumcision, meaning the Gentiles did not need to be circumcised. They did not need to be converted first to Judaism before they would be converted to Christianity, which was almost an absolute condition at the start. But they weren't able to meet a compromise. They opened the doors to the Gentiles. Why? Because they managed to open their minds at some point. This is Catholicity of work. The opposite of Catholicity is exclusiveness. Catholicity is learning to be inclusive, opening minds, opening doors, opening hearts, and saying these are also children of God. You don't start by condemning them. That is why, you know, the early Christians became very famous for some slogans like circumcision of the heart. Meaning, circumcision has become spiritual. It was spiritualized. It's not about the foreskin of your genital. The more important circumcision is circumcision of the heart. They would say Sabbath was made for man, not man for Sabbath. So who says that keeping the Sabbath day is an absolute condition? And before they knew it, their Sabbath became the day of resurrection. It is not what enters into, but what comes out of the mouth that makes a man unclean. This is their argument to people who question them for eating pork. Both Jewish and Islamic tradition detest pork as unclean. And how did it happen that even if we came from the Jewish tradition, we started opening to unclean food, dirty food? Well, ang sagot simple na, hindi yung pumapasok sa bibigang magpapadumi sa tao, kundi lumalabas ang mga bibig. So can you imagine that the early evangelists, how they used these lines as favorite slogans against doctrinaires who are called Judaizers. Ito yung kalaban ni Paul, mga Judaizers. Remember in Galatia, that was a big issue. Parang nasugot si Paul ng mga Judaizers who told the converts that they were not really Christians because they were not circumcised. Galit ni Paul. He denounced them, these Judaizers. Many of them came from Jerusalem. There was still then a tension between the Jerusalem community and the Gentile Christian communities. Pero magaling si Lord alam ko, paano na resolve talaga yung problem? It was not the council that resolved the problem. In 70 AD, nilusog ng Romans ang Jerusalem and destroyed the temple all over again and destroyed the city all over again. Kaya yung mga Christians in Jerusalem, they had no choice but to flee as refugees. Eh, saan sila makikisuko? Saan sila makikisigo? Eh, di dito sa mga taong dati nilang dinidinaw sa hindi natanggap na Christian. The members of the Gentile Christian communities. Parang poetic justice ko. God, you know, resolved the problem with the historical development like